What are the best books ever written? I've been on a mission, an adventure, a quest for over 2 decades now trying to find the right answer to that question, and I think I have the answer. By the way, watch my companion video on how to read more books, the best books, and how to read them more effectively. After reading thousands of books, carefully sifting through all the great books lists, from the most well-read scholars, theologians, writers, politicians, taking note of the books that keep being repeated in all these lists, let me give you the top 12 greatest books ever written. The 12, if you will. And there is not a Judas Iscariot in the mix. This is my opinion, but I'm right. I do have a painstakingly carefully chosen lifetime reading list of around 1,200 books based on all my research. At this point, I've read around half of that book list, but I've made sure and prioritized reading the most praised, recommended, beloved books from that list first. In other words, these 12 best books of all time have emerged from that 1,200 book list, and those 1,200 books came from the most well-read individuals that have ever walked this planet. Could there be other books I discover in the future that are better than some of these 12? It's possible, but I think highly unlikely. Even after another, God willing, 60 years of reading, I don't think these 12 will ever be surpassed. If I'm proven wrong, I'll record an updated video. One more thing, these aren't just books. Almost all of them are epic journeys, adventures, odysseys. You could spend an entire lifetime reading each one and still not exhaust them. I plan to keep rereading and leading groups through them for the rest of my life. The journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. Reading through these books begins with opening to the first page. Before I list the 12, here are 2 preparatory type books you must read before you start your lifetime reading list. First, How to Read a Book by Mortimer Adler. This is the greatest book ever written on how to read well. I first read this in seminary and continue to go back to it 20 years later. It's a masterclass and far more interesting than it sounds. And he discusses and lists many of the great books within. Adler put together the famous Great Books of the Western World series, by the way. Second, On Writing by Stephen King. This is the best book ever written on writing. It's so good it will inspire you to write a novel. Forget about the fact that Stephen King is a psycho. I follow him on Twitter, so I know. But he is a brilliant writer, and he gives you so much to chew on and inspire you in this book. Without further ado, behold the 12 most actionable, wisdom per page, filled with the good, the true, and the beautiful books of all time. More important than anything else, they inspire me, and I hope they will inspire you to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Jesus Christ. Number 12, The Lord of the Rings by J.R.R. Tolkien. This book is like lightning from a clear sky. Probably no book yet written in the world is quite such a radical instance of what its author has elsewhere called subcreation. The names alone are a feast. Here are beauties which pierce like swords or burn like cold iron. Here is a book that will break your heart. They will know that this is good news, good beyond hope. So says C.S. Lewis in his review of The Lord of the Rings. Truly an odyssey, an adventure, the greatest fiction and fantasy book of the 20th century. It has been proven in poll after poll to be one of the most beloved books in all the world. The BBC did a big read poll in 2003, where they asked almost 1 million readers their favorite book of all time, and Lord of the Rings was number 1. Waterstones Books did a poll looking for the book of the century, and to the horror of the critics, experts everywhere, they chose Lord of the Rings. Then the Daily Telegraph and others conducted their own polls for the book of the century with the same result. In one of them, Lord of the Rings ranked number 2, but the critics still weren't happy because the Bible was number 1. Then when it dawned on them that the Bible was not written in the 20th century, Lord of the Rings ranked number 1 again. One critic wrote, "Why have we taught these people to read? What has become of our sacred education if they're going to read this juvenile trash?" Other critics used expletives. Why do people, setting aside the critics, love The Lord of the Rings and Peter Jackson's trilogy so much? It is, of course, a great story, but there are many fun and entertaining stories, and they don't sell over 150 million copies. Only around 20 books in all human history have sold over 100 million copies. There's something deeper going on. I believe it is because it is at its foundation a Christian work, and it vividly and creatively captures the most essential elements of the Christian story. Tolkien admitted as such. He even said in one of his letters that The Lord of the Rings is all about God and his sole right to divine honor. We also see 3 Christ figures all dying and rising and saving Middle Earth in their own way. Gandalf is the prophet, Frodo is the priest, and Aragorn is the king. Christ himself and shadowy images of his offices and his works are what we all long for. Tolkien gives us the goods on that front. Read it slowly. Take your time. Read a little every day and get through it in a year. Listen to Rob Inglis or Andy Serkis, who played Sméagol Gollum, read the audio versions. Both are excellent. Whatever you do, read this book. Number 11, Blaise Pascal's Pensées. St. Augustine is my exemplar theologian. Spurgeon is my exemplar pastor. And Blaise Pascal is my exemplar apologist. For over a decade, I have sought to follow his apologetic method. He wrote this, "Men despise religion. They hate it and fear it is true. To remedy this, we must begin by showing that religion is not contrary to reason, that it is worthy of reverence and respect. Then we must make it attractive, to make good men wish it were true, and then prove that it is true. Worthy of reverence because it really understands human nature, attractive because it promises the true good." This is just one of around 1,000 pensées in French, meaning thoughts, from Pascal's great work. It really isn't a book, but fragments from a grand apologetic work Pascal was planning before his early death at 39 years old. This gathering of Pascal's thoughts, ideas, pithy maxims, and proverbs has become a philosophical and apologetic classic. Imagine if he finished it! He was truly a prodigy, a genius from an early age. He was a mathematician, scientist, inventor. He was a major contributor to probability theory, which set the stage for Leibniz to invent calculus. He invented the first calculator at age 16, which became a forerunner for computer engineering. In his 20s, Pascal wrote mathematical and scientific papers that boggled the minds of the intellectual elite of his day, including the philosopher Descartes, of whom Pascal said in one pensée, "Descartes, useless." When he turned his mind to write his first literary work, The Provincial Letters, it became known as one of the greatest works of French prose ever written. He then took that genius mind and applied it to demonstrating the truth of Christianity to the skeptical intellectual world of 17th century France. This Christian apologetic work of genius, at least in fragments, is called the Pensées. Friedrich Nietzsche, who despised almost all Christian authors, was most impressed with Pascal. He went so far as to say that he would never forgive Christianity for taking Pascal. As one of Pascal's greatest pensées says, "Jesus Christ is the object of everything and the center to which everything tends. Whoever knows him knows the reason for everything." Pascal's Pensées is the greatest apologetic book ever written, and you will learn more about human nature, the psychology of the heart and soul, life and death, Jesus Christ, his extraordinary deeds and miracles, death and resurrection, than just about any other book except the ones following on this list of 12. I also recommend reading Christianity for Modern Pagans by Peter Kreft as well. It is the best commentary on Pascal's thoughts, and it really is a classic in and of itself. Number 10, Shakespeare's Hamlet. Reading Shakespeare is very different in your 30s and 40s than reading it in high school or college. It is truly a tragedy at a Shakespearean level, that the vast majority who have read Shakespeare over the last 60 years only read him in their teens and early 20s. Shakespeare was written for adults who have lived, who have loved, who have been betrayed, cheated, harmed, experienced life. I can't encourage everyone enough to get back into Shakespeare. Hamlet I recommend above all, but also Macbeth, The Tempest, King Lear, and Julius Caesar. I've read at this point about half of Shakespeare's canon, and every one of them moved and challenged me deeply. I find the Christian worldview at the heart of every play I've read, Hamlet above all. My favorite quote that was a key theme in my book, The Bedrock of Christianity, is when Hamlet says in response to Horatio's skepticism that Hamlet's dead father's ghost is appearing to people, he says, "There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy." Read Shakespeare and you will find so much more in heaven and earth than is dreamt of in your philosophy. Number 9, The Imitation of Christ by St. Thomas Aquinas. It is truly extraordinary that a monk living in the 1400s, not known outside of his little monastery and his disciples in the Netherlands, wrote 4 booklets on the spiritual life to guide his novices, and those 4 booklets became the book, The Imitation of Christ. It is one of the most published, read, and translated books of church history. It is the greatest devotional work on the spiritual life ever written. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was reading The Imitation of Christ the night before he was hanged. John Wesley and John Newton read The Imitation of Christ right before their conversions. Thomas Aquinas is behind the immortal hymn, Amazing Grace. Years ago, I preached a sermon series on pursuing holiness based on the main themes of this book, and it was one of the most impactful series our church experienced. The Imitation of Christ is to be read a little bit every day. Pray as you read him, memorize and meditate on his teachings. He's one of the few authors that I've read where holiness emerges from every page. He lived into his 90s. He must have been a truly holy presence. My all-time favorite quote that I can't read without bowing down afterward and confessing how I've fallen short of my love for Jesus. He wrote, "Jesus has now many lovers of his heavenly kingdom, but few bearers of his cross. He has many desirous of consolation, but few of tribulation. He finds many companions of his table, but few of his abstinence. All desire to rejoice with him, few are willing to endure anything for him or with him. Many follow Jesus unto the breaking of bread, but few to the drinking of the cup of his passion. Many reverence his miracles, few follow the ignominy of his cross. Many love Jesus so long as no adversities befall them. Many praise and bless him so long as they receive any consolations from him. But if Jesus hide himself and leave them but a little while, they fall either into complaining or into too much dejection of mind. But they who love Jesus for the sake of Jesus, and not for some special comfort of their own, bless him in all tribulation and anguish of heart, as well as in the state of highest comfort. Yea, although he should never be willing to give them comfort, they notwithstanding would ever praise him, and wish to be always giving thanks. Oh, how powerful is the pure love of Jesus, which is mixed with no self-interest or self-love." Amen. Number 8, Plato's Republic. Plato is one of the most beloved pagan writers by Christians throughout church history, and rightly so. Justin Martyr and Augustine baptized Plato, and Aquinas baptized Aristotle. C.S. Lewis has the professor in the Chronicles of Narnia say to the children, "It's all in Plato, bless me. What do they teach them at these schools?" The older ones laughed. My favorite is from Erasmus. He said this about Socrates, "An admirable spirit, surely, and one who had not known Christ in the sacred scriptures. And so when I read such things of such men, I can hardly help exclaiming, Saint Socrates, pray for us." Plato's dialogues are priceless treasures. The Republic is the greatest of them all. But I recommend starting with Plato's Apology. It's shorter and gives you a feel of how these dialogues work if you haven't read one. I've taken two groups through the Republic, and both times it was one of the most rewarding experiences. I can't improve on what Will Durant says in his The Greatest Minds and Ideas of All Time. He says, "Are you interested in anything? Read the Republic. Here you shall find metaphysics, theology, ethics, psychology, theory of education, theory of statesmanship, theory of art. Here you shall find feminism and birth control, communism and socialism with all their virtues and their difficulties, eugenics and libertarian education, aristocracy and democracy, vitalism and psychoanalysis. What shall you not find there?" Number 7, The Divine Comedy by Dante. Dante might very well save your life. In fact, Rod Dreher wrote a book with that very title, How Dante Saved My Life. I wouldn't say he saved my life, but incredibly, I first began reading Dante at 35 years old, the age of Dante when he enters the dark wood on the path to hell. I've now taken this extraordinary journey 3 times, and God willing, I hope to many times more in this life. The female inkling Dorothy Sayers is an excellent guide. You should read her 3 Penguin Classics translations and her brilliant and copious notes. There are 100 cantos or chapters. 1 introductory chapter, 33 in hell, 33 in purgatory, and 33 in paradise. On the evening of Good Friday, a man on the run from a death sentence wakes up in a dark forest, lost, terrified, and besieged by wild animals. He spends an infernal Easter week hiking through a dismal cave, climbing up a grueling mountain, and taking what you might call the long way home. It all works out for him, though. The traveler returns from his ordeal a better man, determined to help others learn from his experience. He writes a book about his to hell and back trek, and it's an instant bestseller, making him beloved and famous. For 700 years, that gripping adventure story has been dazzling readers and even changing the lives of some of them. How do I know? Because it pretty much saved my own life over the past year. Rod Dreher. Try to read 1 canto a day and keep reading until you finish. You will not regret it, and Dante may very well save your life. Number 6, The Cost of Discipleship by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. You can't read The Cost of Discipleship beginning to end and still be the same man. Like Thomas A. Kempis, Bonhoeffer's writings radiate holiness. Someone who knew him said, "When Bonhoeffer walked in a room, you could no longer be a coward." I meditate on Bonhoeffer and his martyrdom, read his writings every year on my birthday, because on April 9th, 1945, Bonhoeffer was hanged by the Nazis. Many of his writings have survived, Ethics, his letters from prison, and they are all excellent. But his masterpiece is The Cost of Discipleship. This wasn't even a book originally. These are the lecture notes from Bonhoeffer's teachings to his students on discipleship in an illegal seminary in Germany. It lasted 2.5 years before it shut down from 1936 to 1937. As far as we know, all his students and Bonhoeffer himself ended up in Nazi prisons. One of the many reasons his words in this book are so powerful, he lived what he preached. As my favorite quote in the entire book says, "When Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die." Bonhoeffer also writes, "And if we answer the call to discipleship, where will it lead us? What decisions and partings will it demand? To answer this question, we shall have to go to him. For only he knows the answer. Only Jesus Christ, who bids us follow him, knows the journey's end. But we do know that it will be a road of boundless mercy. Discipleship means joy." Bonhoeffer would confess later, "This is a dangerous book. Read this dangerous book." Number 5, Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis. "I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything else." This quote is not from Mere Christianity, but from an essay Lewis wrote called "Is Theology Poetry?" But it captures the running theme through all Lewis's works, that through the lens of the Christian worldview, we see everything more clearly. And Lewis himself gives us new eyes and metaphors to see the world as it truly is. Mere Christianity is Lewis's premier work that does this, in my opinion. I could be biased because this is one of the first books I read when I became a Christian over 20 years ago in college. It stimulated my love for reading theology and apologetics and Lewis himself. But I don't think I am biased because Christianity Today surveyed 100 of their contributors and church leaders across the country for the best Christian books of the 20th century. By far, C.S. Lewis was the most popular author and Mere Christianity was ranked number 1. If you've never read Lewis, Mere Christianity is the place to start. One of my favorite books to give away to new believers and unbelievers is Mere Christianity. If Billy Graham led the most people to Christ in the 20th century through preaching, then C.S. Lewis led the most people, particularly intellectuals, to Christ through his books, chief among them, Mere Christianity. Like Bonhoeffer's The Cost of Discipleship, this wasn't originally a book either. Mere Christianity is the book form of lectures C.S. Lewis delivered in broadcast talks during World War II to teach everyone plain Christianity that no Christian disagrees with. He achieved this goal because I know of no other author as ecumenically widely read as Lewis. Anglicans, Protestants, Catholics, Eastern Orthodox all claim him. I remember going to a Mormon bookstore one time, and they had an entire section for C.S. Lewis. I think he's the only non-Mormon author in the entire store. As Elizabeth Elliot answered when she was asked, "How can a person deepen his theology and become a clear thinker?" She answered, "Study the Bible and study C.S. Lewis." People are always saying C.S. Lewis was not a theologian, and Lewis himself would say that, but he was. He covered the whole field of theology in popular, understandable language. The fact that he could put it in simple language is proof to me that he understood it better than many theologians. Oh, so true. Number 4, The Everlasting Man by G.K. Chesterton. Speaking of C.S. Lewis, I've read his spiritual autobiography and all his 3 volumes of surviving letters, and the book he recommends to people more often than any other is Chesterton's The Everlasting Man. He calls it the greatest apologetic book ever written. Lewis also wrote in Surprised by Joy, "In reading Chesterton, as in reading George MacDonald, I did not know what I was letting myself in for. A young man who wishes to remain a sound atheist cannot be too careful of his reading. There are traps everywhere, Bibles laid open, millions of surprises, as Herbert says, fine nets and stratagems. God is, if I may say it, very unscrupulous." Chesterton's orthodoxy, his version of Mere Christianity, which is better, I would say, but Lewis wrote in more understandable language, and The Everlasting Man are dangerous books to leave lying around. Whatever you do, don't give these books to atheists. There is some kind of atheist and agnostic curing antidote in these books. The Everlasting Man is the greatest book ever written on Jesus outside of the 4 Gospels. Let me read to you one of my favorite quotes, and after reading it, and so many like it in this book, it's difficult not to get out of your chair and bow down in worship to Christ, the everlasting man. Chesterton here is imagining the wise men who came to see Jesus, 2 of them at least, as Confucius and Buddha. He wrote this, "Such learned men would doubtless have come, as these learned men did come, to find themselves confirmed in much that was true in their own traditions and right in their own reasoning. Confucius would have found a new foundation for the family in the very reversal of the Holy Family. Buddha would have looked upon a new renunciation of stars rather than jewels and divinity rather than royalty. These learned men would still have the right to say, or rather a new right to say, that there was truth in their old teaching. But after all, these learned men would have come to learn. They would have come to complete their conceptions with something they had not yet conceived, even to balance their imperfect universe with something they might once have contradicted. Buddha would have come from his impersonal paradise to worship a person. Confucius would have come from his temples of ancestor worship to worship a child. So good. Number 3, The Brothers Karamazov by Fyodor Dostoevsky. Philosophy, history, and apologetics speak truth. Literature shows truth. The Brothers Karamazov is the greatest work of literature ever written. There is no competition. As Jordan Peterson once said, Dostoevsky's novels are more true than any history. The stories never happen, but in another sense, they happen every day. In his 20s, Dostoevsky was a part of a revolutionary group that hoped to overthrow the Russian Tsar, Nicholas I, and replace it with a form of socialism. They were all arrested and sentenced to death by a firing squad. As Dostoevsky was chained to a post with a cloth covering his head, he heard them say, "One, two," then he and others were pardoned at the last minute. What does that do to a person, to look into the face of certain death and yet live? There's a great scene in the movie Fight Club where Tyler Durden does this to a convenience store clerk. He puts a gun to his head and asks him, "What do you want to do with your life, Raymond K. Hessel?"
"Raymond, you're going to die." "Is that your mom and dad? Mom and dad are going to have to call up kindly Dr. So-and-so. Pick up your dental records, want to know why. Because there's going to be nothing left to face.
Oh, come on.
An expired community college student ID. What'd you study, Raymond?"
"Stuff."
"Stuff? Were the midterms hard?" "I asked you what you studied."
"Biology, mostly."
"Why?"
"I don't know."
"What did you want to be, Raymond K. Hessel?" "The question, Raymond, was what did you want to be?"
"Answer him, Raymond, Jesus."
Veterinarian.
"Animals."
"Yeah, animals. So..."
"Stuff, yeah, I got that. That means you have to get more schooling."
"Too much school."
"Would you rather be dead?"
"No."
"You'd rather die here on your knees in the back of a convenience store?"
"No, please stop.
I'm keeping your license. Gonna check in on you. I know where you live. If you're not on your way to becoming a veterinarian in 6 weeks, you will be dead. Now run on home."
Afterward, Tyler gives this profound commentary. "Tomorrow will be the most beautiful day of Raymond K. Hessel's life. His breakfast will taste better than any meal you and I have ever tasted." Dostoevsky's breakfast tasted better than any meal you and I have ever tasted that next morning. We see that in a letter he wrote on the very same day he was pardoned. "Life is a gift. Life is happiness. Each minute might have been an age of happiness. Now, changing my life, I am being reborn into a new form. Brother, I swear to you, I shall not lose hope and shall preserve my spirit and heart in purity. I shall be reborn to a better thing. That is my whole hope, my whole comfort." In his novel, The Idiot, he also has his Christ-like character, Prince Mishkin, tell a story of a man condemned to execution but pardoned at the last minute. He describes his, most likely Dostoevsky's, inner thoughts seconds before like this: "What if I didn't have to die? What if I could get my life back? What an infinity it would be! And it would all be mine. Then I would make each minute into a whole lifetime. I would lose nothing, would account for each minute, waste nothing in vain." He said that this idea finally turned into such fury that he wanted them to shoot him as quickly as possible. That is the greatest commentary on Ephesians 5:16, "Buy back the time," that I've ever read. Maybe this is what we all need, to taste death, embrace it, and then be given new life. Dostoevsky would go on to a Siberian prison for the next 4 years in hard labor. Here he would meet thieves, murderers, rapists, the worst of humanity, but he still saw the image of God in them and found them to be humble and repentant. He wrote about this in his more nonfiction work, Notes from the House of the Dead. But the one book that Dostoevsky read in that Siberian prison was a Russian New Testament that was given to him after he was pardoned. He would keep that New Testament until his death. With all these incredible experiences behind him, he would go on to write his 4 great novels, Crime and Punishment, Demons, The Idiot, and The Brothers Karamazov. If you've never read Dostoevsky, you should begin with Crime and Punishment. But The Brothers Karamazov is his masterpiece. Nietzsche, Freud, Wittgenstein, Cormac McCarthy, and of recent Jordan Peterson, Beast from X-Men, and even Fievel from American Tale, have all called it one of the greatest novels ever written. Dostoevsky is the closest thing to a modern-day prophet, predicting what nihilism and atheism would do in the 20th century. He is a psychologist of the soul, understanding the depths of human nature that can only be compared with Shakespeare and the Bible. And lastly, he presents the beauty of Jesus Christ more than any other author of fiction. I agree with Peter Kreft when he wrote, "No human author after the Gospels has ever successfully portrayed Jesus as a convincing dramatic character. There are only two possible exceptions. One of them is Dostoevsky in The Grand Inquisitor, where Christ speaks not one single word. The other is C.S. Lewis in The Narnia Chronicles." Read Dostoevsky to be ravished by the love and beauty of Christ and his redemption. Number two, Confessions by St. Augustine. After teaching Greek 1 and 2 at Dallas Theological Seminary one summer, a student wrote in his course review, "I'll be studying Greek and reading Augustine's Confessions thanks to you." One of the greatest sentences I've ever read. But here is a better one. In fact, one that I would say is a runner-up to Scripture. "You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." The story of Augustine's life and confessions, and really all our lives, humans made in the image of God, in one sentence. I discovered Confessions in seminary soon after I came to Christ, and I've never gotten over it. It is the greatest book ever written, outside what will be number one. And I'm not the only one who thinks this. Confessions won a Great Books tournament by InterVarsity that broke 64 of the greatest Christian books ever written into four brackets, and Confessions came out number one, even beating out C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity. It was number one with Christian History Magazine and Church Times. It has been published and read by the most important human beings on the planet ever since AD 400. "No book stirs the affections of my soul to love God and Christ with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, as does Augustine's Confessions." In fact, in Augustine's Retractions, which he wrote near the end of his life, he looked back on Confessions and wrote this, "My Confessions and 13 books praise the righteous and good God as they speak either of my evil or good, and they are meant to excite men's minds and affections toward him. At least as far as I am concerned, this is what they did for me when they were being written, and they still do this when I read them." The oldest known portrait of Augustine has an inscription. "The different fathers said different things, but with Roman eloquence, this man said all things, thundering forth the sense of the mysteries." A modern Augustinian scholar wrote, "After 40 years, I can still meditate on one book of the Confessions during a week-long retreat and come back feeling frustrated that there is still so much more gold to mine in those few pages. I, for one, know that I shall never in this life escape from the Augustinian Alps." If you've never read Augustine, Confessions is the best place to start, and then you can continue his joyful and unending quest for God and the city of God and the Trinity, which added to Confessions form a kind of sublime Trinity. Behold what St. Augustine said a year before he died in a letter to his friend Darius concerning how to read his Confessions. It's excellent advice, still 1,600 years later. He wrote, "Receive then, my son, receive, good sir and good Christian that you are, not on the surface only, but with Christian charity. Receive, I say, the books of my Confessions which you longed for. In them, behold me and praise me not beyond what I am. In them, believe what I say of myself, not what others say of me. Look upon me there and see what I was in myself and of myself. If anything in me pleases you, join me in praising him to whom I wish praise given for what he has done for me. And do not praise me, for he made us and not we ourselves. We indeed had destroyed ourselves, but he that fashioned us also refashioned us. When you find me in those pages, pray for me that I may avoid defection and reach perfection. Pray, my son, pray for me." Number one, the book of books, the Holy Bible. Do not think for a moment I am saying the Bible is the greatest book ever written and given to mankind because I'm a Christian or because I have to say it due to some fake pious devotion. It's simply the truth. There would be no Confessions, or Brothers Karamazov, or Cost of Discipleship, or The Everlasting Man, or Mere Christianity, or even Shakespeare, without the Bible. The Bible laid the foundations of Western civilization, but also the foundations for the greatest literature, poetry, plays, art, music, and even cinema. It is the best-selling book of all time. The New York Times lies to you every week when it says this or that book is number one. No, it's the Bible, every week. An estimated 5 billion sold. It's the most translated book of all time. The Wycliffe Bible Translator's stated mission is to translate the Bible into every language on the planet. It's the most copied book. It's the most read book. It's the most expensive book. The most banned and burned book. Even the most stolen book of all time. Jordan Peterson said at the beginning of his Bible lectures on Genesis, "The Bible has outlasted kingdoms, many, many kingdoms. This book is more durable than stone, than castles, more durable than an empire." Why haven't you read it? Oh, because you're not religious? Astrophysicist and atheist Neil deGrasse Tyson listed the Bible as one of the 8 books every human being on the planet should read. Sam Harris has the Bible on his top recommended list. The Bible is number 4 in Tim Ferriss's Tools for Titans most recommended books. Virtually any great books list you can find has the Bible on it and near the top. That cannot be said for the Quran, the Book of Mormon, or Dianetics. In fact, it's laughable to compare any other religious work to the Bible. Since I was 20 years old, I have been reading the Bible through every year, and for the first decade, sometimes twice a year. I find it incredible and awe-inspiring that no matter how many times I read this or that passage, I find in it something new. Paraphrasing what Aslan said to Lucy, "As I grow, the Bible grows bigger and grander." I could give 10,000 reasons why you should read the Bible, but let me give you what wakes me up in the morning, excited to go into the backyard, open these divine treasures, and read them aloud for 30 minutes to an hour. I grew up on 80s and 90s action movies, and one of the common tropes is the wise master guru Yoda-type figure living on some mountain somewhere in Asia, and you have to go to him to be taught wisdom. You find this in American Ninja, in Kickboxer, Kill Bill, Batman Begins, and so many others. When Christ opened my eyes, I realized that all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge people are searching for in the movies, but also in real life, is right here at my fingertips. If you could hear the voice of God by climbing to the top of some mountain in Tibet, wouldn't you drop everything right now, travel to Tibet, and start climbing? But you have the oracles of God in your own language, right next to you, waiting to speak to you. This is the mountain of wisdom that I get to climb every morning, and Jesus Christ is at the top of that mountain. The more I climb, the more I see him. Those are the 12 greatest books ever written. For all unbelievers watching, I close with a challenge to you. In various contexts of lectures or debates, I have given this challenge to unbelievers many times. G.K. Chesterton said, "Christianity has not been tried and found wanting, but has been found difficult and left untried." This is so true. It's rare to find someone who truly understands Christianity and has rejected it. I challenge you to read with an open mind 5 of the books I just discussed. The Gospel of Luke, or any of the 4 Gospels, St. Augustine's Confessions, Blaise Pascal's Pensées, Chesterton's Orthodoxy, and C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity. If you still reject Christ and Christianity after you've read those 5 books, then I will admit you have tried and understood Christianity and found it wanting. Be careful, though. These are dangerous books to read if you want to remain a sound atheist. Happy reading.